de zucht naar perfectie in aflevering 4 van In de ban van de roos.
Gebeurde er toen de Chinese rozen in Europa aankwamen. De doorbloeiende Chinese roos en de elegante theeroos met zijn lange langzaam opengaande knoppen. Hoe zijn daaruit de moderne rozen ontstaan? De theehybride of grootbloemige rozen en de floribunda's, ook wel trosrozen genoemd. Roger Phillips gaat lunchen bij de familie Maillon in de Provence. Deze topkwekerij heeft naast talloze andere rassen de beroemdste theehybride aller tijden gewonnen. Peace.
Always in our family we had someone from the family that was free to create whatever he wanted as such. Had a little piece of land, some plants, and do what you want. Just like as a painter that does need to eat from his painting. But can create tremendous things. And since she started 6 years ago, we are happy, Jack. We see some things that are continuing.
Right, every day when we get our lunch, I bring one rose, one very fragrant rose with a different smell. And everybody tried it. And that's the joke of the day, the joke of the week.
So the invention is done at the table.
The ideas, I'm sure it is.
De kunst van het rozen veredelen was in het begin van de vorige eeuw volstrekt onbekend. Er werd niet eens gericht gekruist. Maar toen kwam de wetenschappelijke aanpak op. Op een boerderij in Wiltshire wordt een tipje van de sluier opgelicht.
The arrival of roses from China, and in particular the stud roses that had the repeat flowering gene in them, caused a terrific explosion in rose development. But it was about 50 years later, there was an enormous advance made in the technique for actually breeding the roses. And this was caused by a man who, for his living, actually bred cattle.
Een veeboer in Wiltshire, Henry Bennett, kon niet meer op tegen het goedkope rundvlees uit Amerika en besloot over te stappen op rozen. Hij merkte dat rozenveredelaars de nieuwste wetenschappelijke ontwikkelingen niet kenden.
Although everybody had been for about 40, 50 years aware that you could actually cross roses, they'd done it in a rather haphazard way. And in fact, even books as late as 1840 said if you wanted to breed a new rose, you literally planted two putative parents alongside each other and hoped that they would cross and you picked up the seed.
Veredelaars boekten wel successen met de nieuwe Chinese rozen. Ze hadden een doorbloeiende Chinese roos naast een Portland roos gezet. Dankzij bestuiving door insecten was zo de remontant hybride ontstaan, die en lang bloeide, zoals de Chinese roos, en grote geurige bloemen had, zoals de Europese. Maar zoals John Mattock al zei, de veredelaars hadden weinig greep op het eindresultaat.
It suddenly struck Bennett that what he'd got to do is he'd actually got to select parents. And so he proceeded on exactly the same lines as when he was breeding his cattle, by selecting parents, identifying them, and using the characteristics of a male against a female, or vice versa.
Technically, how did he actually achieve that?
If you'd left it normally on a plant, then the pollen would develop, which is the male part of the plant, and that would automatically fertilize the female part. So what he did, he emasculated plant. That is, that he got hold of a putative female plant, and he took off the petals, and then he took away the pollen. So you were then left with a female plant. And then what he did then was he found his potential male, he collected the male pollen, and he put this on the female plant, and he had what, for all intents and purposes these days, you call planned parenthood.
Zo kon Bennett de nieuwe herbloeiende remontant-hybride kruisen met de Chinese theeroos. De grote prestatie van Bennett was dat dankzij hem het veredelingsproces beheersbaar werd. Dat leidde tot een stortvloed aan nieuwe rozen. De wetenschap maakte snelle vorderingen en de mens dacht even dat hij de natuur zou leren beheersen. De rozenveredelaar kon voor God spelen en rozen op maat ontwerpen. In 1879 lanceerde Bennett zijn nieuwe rozen. Hij noemde deze grootbloemige rozen theehybride.
The French, however, laid claim to being the first breeders of hybrid teas. A man called Guyot, using the hit-and-miss method of planting nice roses together and then planting the seeds from them, produced this rose, La France, still widely grown today.
Maar Bennett had geen twijfels over het belang van zijn eigen prestaties.
When Bennett actually advertised the first 10 of his varieties, he proudly pronounced them as actually the first 10 hybrid teas that are actually whose progeny and whose hybridization had actually been planned.
Maar goede ouders uitkiezen was niet genoeg. Even belangrijk was inzicht in welk kind later een prijswinnaar kon worden.
About 100 years ago, I went to St. Christopher School up the road. We used to run down here on our cross-country run. Hardness roses was always a mystery to me. Now I'm going to find out what really goes on.
In deze kassen staan 50.000 verschillende zaailingen. Philip Harkness laat een paar rozen zien die in de toekomst misschien de catalogus zullen halen.
Yeah, that one is absolutely beautiful, isn't it? What a lovely shape, color. It's absolutely pure and clean somehow.
Now, is that something you tried to achieve, do you think?
The honest answer is no. I think it's just something that turned up. The parents on that one happened both to be deep red. So we're actually looking through red rose here and we found quite a nice pink one.
And how are you, what are you achieving here, do you think?
Well, we're using Savoy Hotel here, which is an excellent healthy variety with good form. And you can see the shape of the flowers that it gives us and the size of the flowers, which is really what you're looking for in a hybrid tea.
Yes, and what about scent for them?
In these particular ones, this batch, unfortunately, haven't given us the scent that we would like.
Oh dear. Does that mean therefore the chop or your...
No, it means further development, really. If we get something which, this pale colored one is nice, we can breed on with something like this and we can breed perfume into it.
Tijdens de lunch in de Provence was Jacques Mouchot lyrisch geweest over kweken op geur.
Something that is not very well known by most gardeners, that there is not the rose fragrance. You've got to put an S at the end of that word. It's rose fragrances. And it's completely amazing the differences in fragrances that you can get in roses. Well, to give you an example, from anise smell to citrus smell, to rose smell. That's one example. But there in between you've got even more. You find the fetida smell that you can improve and enrich a mix of fetida smell together with anise smell. You've got something completely incredible that can get the attention of the fragrance industry.
I smelt your anise rose. You call it Ricard.
We call it Paul Ricard.
Paul, yes. Ricard, yeah. Paul Ricard.
Well, when that rose was happening in the field, it was for us obvious. It was in the same time the color of a pastis, when you put water inside, and the smell of a pastis. When I came out to the office, I say, I discovered a rose that has a color and the smell of pastis. Everybody laughed at me. You say, you gotta be crazy. You had too much pastis yourself.
Volgens Philip Harkness is er voor een roos met bepaalde eigenschappen nog steeds heel veel geluk nodig en vooral engelengeduld. Twee ouders leveren nooit twee keer hetzelfde kind op. In de tijd van Bennett werden rozen vermeerderd door enting. Tegenwoordig wordt er geoculeerd, een moderne vorm van enten. Alleen zo zijn de honderdduizenden planten te maken die nodig zijn om te kunnen blijven draaien.
And what we do is we cut the flowers off and for convenience we take all the thorns off and we cut away all the leaves.
Yeah.
Inside where each leaf has come off there's an auxiliary bud and that can be grown into a plant. After that we slice this bud out of the stem and when we do that we will have just a sliver of bark and the bud like this. The next phase is to insert the bud into the rootstock. And we do that by making a T cut, which goes across the top and up the side. And then we open the bark and we just slide our bud in there, trim it off to make it neat and tidy. And then the next act is just to put a patch on it so that it keeps the dirt out and the moisture in. And that just clips on there like that, that's it.
Het gokelement blijft, maar gericht een roos ontwerpen is nu wel mogelijk.
It's a beauty that is made a little bit by man and then very much by God. It's something that is shape and colors and fragrance and foliage. I mean, it's harmonious plant. But if you look carefully at nature, very few flowers do have blooms during the whole season. And that's why they don't take so many diseases. And roses has more disease than any other plant, for sure.
Really?
Oh yeah, for sure. But still you have flowers that you can admire on a plant or cut and put in a little flower arrangement on your table. And it's the only shrub that do repeat. Azalea bloom once a year, camellia once a year, forsythia once a year.
De rozenveredelaars waren niet te stuiten. In de eeuw daarna werden talloze nieuwe theehybriden gewonnen. Maar zelfs in de hoogtijdagen van de theehybriden waren er veredelaars die vonden dat ook andere wegen bewandeld konden worden.
This is a dwarf version of the Chinese rose, Rosa multiflora. It was bred into the polyantha roses, a group of very small plants. Later, the polyanthas were crossed with hybrid teas, and that led to a whole new race of roses, the floribundas.
Een fraai rosarium in de Verenigde Staten bevat een verzameling moderne rozen, historisch gerangschikt.
Here, Roger. Let me catch you the perfect boutonniere rose. From the 1880s. Put it in your buttonhole here.
Oh, I can get a smell of that. Is that Mademoiselle Cecil Brunner?
It sure is.
Yeah. We're here today in California at the Huntington Garden talking to Claire Martin, who's the creator of roses. And we're looking at the historic beds they've laid out of the modern roses, the floribundas and hybrid teas. Claire, how have you got it organized here?
Well, this early bed are the earliest hybrid teas. The beginnings of the floribunda rose with polyanthas like Mademoiselle Cecile Brunner. And the garden in this area is laid out chronologically, so each bed has a decade to itself.
So this is around 1900, sort of period?
Right. Mm-hmm.
This, of course, is a parent of the floribundas, isn't
right,
it?
Right, and a cross with the tea rose.
And here we've got Ellen Poulsen, which some people call the first of the actual floribundas proper.
Yes, you can see how the flower size is getting much larger now.
We're now coming up towards the 1920s.
Right, and if we go on up the garden a bit, we can get into the 1930s and see some of the real floribundas starting. This is Snowbird. It was introduced by Conard Pyle in 1936.
So it's an American rose?
Yes. And it's one of those that we're not really sure whether it's a hybrid tea, or floribunda. It has all those characteristics.
So it doesn't really. It looks a bit like a hybrid tea, but it doesn't have those really tall, tight buds of a hybrid tea.
Right. And it also comes in a climbing form, which is right over here on the pillar right over here.
And that's going up, what, 20 feet?
Easily. 25? Right.
Yeah. And we're coming up into the 40s here, are we, Claire?
Right, to a 1949's rose called Masquerade. I think it shows a really unique characteristic, almost a throwback to the China roses, in that the color starts out the lighter tone, darkens to the medium tone, and actually ends up this nice dark red tone. Roger, come on around this side of the bed and let's look at some other 40s roses. This is actually going back a year with Lady Anne Kidwell. This is a rose that was hybridized by a local man by the name of Marsh.
Ah, so this is part of your real local collection here.
Right, and Red Sweetheart. And my favorite, Pasadena Tournament, or we like to call it the Red Cecile Bruner.
Well, I rather like the Pasadena name. It gives you that local twist.
Right. Well, over here we have the climbing form of it. It's, I think, one of the most spectacular roses in the garden.
Een Amerikaanse rozenveredelaar zou verantwoordelijk zijn geweest voor het ontstaan van de beroemdste Meillan-roos.
My father was rather young. He had an interest to go to the United States. So he went there before in 1933. He made his first trip there when he was 20 years old. He met some people there that were interested in roses. These people told him, well, we need to have you as one of our researchers for giving us some new rose varieties that we need from Europe. So we have something different from the United States breeding work. And that's how, just in, I guess, 1942, in the real war, the last consulate from the United States in Lyon that had a few sticks of roses, budwood, that were shipped to the United States to these friends in Pennsylvania, it was presented at the San Francisco conference of the future United Nations. In 1945, the very same day, Berlin fell.
De roos kreeg de naam Peace en zou de populairste roos aller tijden worden. Heel bijzonder bij Peace was het geel dat erin zat. Volgens Jacques Mouchot was het heel moeilijk geweest om dat te bereiken.
Yellow has always been a very difficult color for roses. Weak plants, the more difficult to grow, fading.
Rosa Fertida, de gele Persische roos, bracht geel in de kweeklijnen, maar ook gevoeligheid voor ziekte en zwakke groei. Het heeft veredelaars bijna een eeuw gekost om gezonde gele rozen te krijgen.
To work the yellow on the breeding side, you've got two ways of working. Working among the existing yellow roses and with very severe selection, improve step by step, or try to include new gene because the genetic base of yellow in roses is very narrow, and we tried that very successfully with some coming back to Rosa Fetida. But then we came to those wonderful yellows that are so stable. And here you've got a very good example of this magnificent Ginella brigida. This is a perfect hybrid tea. All the flowers are born singly on the stems. It makes a very, very thick and big flowers. This one can have sometimes more than 100 petals. And there is absolutely no fading on the rose. And even more, the hotter the sun, the stronger the yellow.
Te veel zon is in Engeland zelden een probleem. Maar toch blijft ook Philip Harkness zoeken naar nieuwe, spannende rozen.
This is one called Samaritan that we've got here, which I find a fascinating rose. If you look at the bud, it's a really traditional hybrid tea type bud. Half three quarters open, lovely shaped flower. And then as the flower finally opens, we have another one here, and it begins to look just like a quartered old-fashioned rose.
Bij Jackson & Perkins in Californië wordt heel grootschalig gewerkt.
What we do is we send budwood to Wasco, where our production is, and we bud them from 10 plants to 50 plants to 500 plants, and at each stage we continue to evaluate and select only the best for further increases. That's when we bring in the marketing people to have their input into the rose to see whether we want to carry it on and turn it commercial.
Is there some point at which you bring in the general public so they can have a look at it and pass an opinion?
We select 4 hybrid tea roses and send them out to 25,000 people, and they evaluate them for 2 years. This is an example of one of the roses that has gone through the various stages of development within the company, and next year will be a new commercial rose with us. It's a Rugosa hybrid.
Yes.
Bred from a Rugosa and a Floribunda, and it's got most of the good qualities of both parents.
This magnificent thing was never released. Hybrid tea selection is very much linked to emotional reasons. And for one reason or another, this one never brought enough emotion to the selection committee and just sitting here, just in our collections.
Er worden elk jaar honderden rozen geïntroduceerd. Welke komt het dichtst in de buurt van de ideale roos? De Engelse Rozenvereniging publiceert elk jaar een rozentop 10. Op de 9e en 10e plaats Paul Scherville, 5 plaatsen gezakt. En Piccadilly. Op de 7e en 8e plaats Freedom, 2 plaatsen gestegen. En vernoemd naar de zoon van Lady Di en Prins Charles, Royal William. Op 6 Alexander van Harkness. Op 5 nog steeds niet te stuiten, Peace. Een gedeelde 4e, 3e en 2e plaats voor Fragrant Cloud, die ook het geurklassement aanvoert. Just Joey, een reus onder de rozen. En van Dixons uit Ierland, Bodus. Maar op de 1e plaats nog steeds Silver Jubilee.
This rose is in many ways a perfect hybrid tea. It's Silver Jubilee, bred in Scotland by Cocker and launched in 1978. The buds are tall, elegant, and really rather strong and thick and well petaled. Eventually, when it opens absolutely fully, it makes a wonderful rose for cutting and having in the house. It's a little bit low on scent, unfortunately, but look at the foliage, it's superb. Healthy, strong and vigorous.
De vorm van de planten laat wel te wensen over. Moderne rozen zijn nogal stakerig, vooral 's winters. Waarom hebben de toch zo knappe veredelaars niet meteen voor mooie planten gezorgd?
Let's go to the Paul McCartney rose.
Het winnen van prijzen heeft daar alles mee te maken.
This is the most ever awarded million roses in international rose contest. We do participate every year in rose contests organized by the main capital city in Europe. And this one came back with more than 20 awards.
Een hartstochtelijk rozenliefhebber heeft er in 1875 voor gezorgd dat de ontwikkeling van de theeroos 1 bepaalde kant op ging. Dean Hall.
I forthwith suggested to all rose growers, amateur and professional, that we should hold a feast of roses, at which the whole brotherhood might meet in love and unity, to drink out of cups of silver success to the queen of flowers.
Toen veredelaars het uiterlijk van een roos vooraf konden bepalen, mikten ze op iets waarmee prijzen te winnen waren. En dat was niet de plant zelf, maar alleen de bloem.
Dating from Dean Hall's time, there is a great interest in growing huge specimen hybrid tea blooms of classic shape. And to grow those, essentially, they do best on plants which aren't terribly good in the garden.
John Mattock's familie veredelt al bijna 120 jaar rozen, vooral theehybride. Hij vindt dat Bennett's wetenschappelijke aanpak is misbruikt.
He produced a hybrid tea that had got the form, which was more important than anything else. Sadly, it was many, many years later we suddenly realized that we were concentrating on form and color rather than on other attributes of the rose, like making it a good shrub or making it a good plant.
In het rosarium in St. Albans is duidelijk te zien dat bij rozen de bloem belangrijker is dan de plant. Een tuineigenaar zal dus moeten kiezen. Een tuin of een rozenshow.
I've now come to Paris, to the garden at the park in Bagatelle. This garden sets out to be the most beautiful rose garden in the world. And I think it succeeds.
Bagatelle is een voorbeeld voor iedereen die een tuin met moderne rozen wil beplanten.
L'objet de la roseraie, c'est d'être un lieu de démonstration des roses modernes. Alors nous avons pour cela soulé un fonds de collection avant 1920, et c'est 20% de la collection, et 80% ce sont des roses de 1920 jusqu'à nos jours, et même des roses qui ne sont pas commercialisées, si vous voulez, par l'intermédiaire des continents.
De zuilen en bogen in Bagatelle geven een verticaal accent dat de rozen op hun voordeligst laat uitkomen.
One of the things that gives that emphasis is these enormous ancient weeping standards. I'm now totally converted to the idea of standards in my garden. New dawn, normally grown as a rampant climber, in fact makes a most successful weeping standard. In the last 20 years or so, there's been a most interesting development in the floribunda roses. A man called McGreedy, working in New Zealand, has produced a series of roses he calls the hand-painted roses. This is Matangi, one of them. They have white petals, you can see from the back and in fact from inside, with a hand-painted or so-called hand-painted area on the petal surface. There have been great advances in hybrid teas and modern roses. In terms of the perfection and size of the flowers, the health and vigor of the plants, and also developments of completely new colors. There are now strong yellows and oranges and really vibrant reds. The question that remains to be asked is, have we thrown out the baby with the bathwater?
We kunnen nu al anderhalve eeuw rozen op bestelling maken. Zijn we vergeten wat de natuur te bieden heeft?
So if you take this, only 10% of nature, it's not sufficient. Let the nature talk itself for itself. You can violate so much, but the nature is one important part of our business in creation. Thank you.